Let's turn into our Bibles to the book of Exodus chapter 25. Now, this will be the last furniture piece we're going to talk about for a while. In the month of February, we'll have the first 3 weeks talking about the structure of the tabernacle. Then we'll conclude the month of February with the brazen altar. Then we'll go into March with the study of the priestly garments. And then we'll finally get into some more of the furniture later on. But this is the last one for a while. Exodus 25, verse 39. The Bible says, "It shall be made of a talent of pure gold with all these utensils." Verse 39 in chapter 25, talking about the lampstand or the golden lampstand or the menorah. The menorah is the Hebrew word for the lampstand. That's why you'll see it in a lot of the Jewish writings and talk about the menorah. It is the same thing as what we see here in the book of Exodus as the lampstand. Now, this lampstand or this menorah was to be made of a talent of pure gold. According to Arthur Pink, he said that that was about 125 pounds or approximately 2,000 ounces. You take the current rate of gold today, that's $1,191.80 per ounce. You're talking $2,383,600. However, the Temple Institute said that a talent was 2,400 ounces, which again, at the going rate of gold, would be $2,860,320, almost $3 million. That's a lot of money for an ornament in a church, isn't it? Man, I'm telling you, how do you like your pastor to say, "We're going to buy a new little fixture over here on the south side of the building, and it's going to cost us $3 million. Don't worry, we can get it in a couple weeks." Now we laugh, but you know, the Temple Institute built this life-size replica, and it's going to be used in the temple, they said, of the menorah, paid cash for it, almost $3 million. And one man from Romania bought it, paid for it. Unbelievable. You know, when it comes to God's house, can we outgive God? It's very interesting, to say the least. Don't worry, that's not giving you an upcoming update that we're going to build something for $3 million. So don't worry, okay? You know, that's why the Nebuchadnezzar took these things back to, when he got a hold of them, took them back to the land. Why? That's a chunk of gold. That's why the Romans took it back to Rome when they destroyed the temple. That's a chunk of gold. But you see, the lampstand and the menorah today is a national emblem of Israel. But in the Old Testament, it too was a national emblem, but it was an emblem of God's light and God's truth. In the intertestamental period between Malachi and Matthew, we read in the Apocrypha, in the first and second Maccabees, that the lampstand was a very important fixture in their history. That's where we got Hanukkah, the festival of light, from. The miracle of the one day worth of oil that lasted 8 days. And therefore, we see that the lampstand was very important even in the times of the intertestamental period. Then also, if you go to Rome today, and if you go to the Arch of Titus, you will see there a picture of the lampstand or the menorah as it's being carried off into triumph into the Gentile world capital. Lo and behold, you will see that the lampstand is a very important matter in the tabernacle as well as in the world. You have a handout today showing an artist's conception of what perhaps the lampstand looked like. We see that there are many, many things on that lampstand, a lot of embellishments. We'll talk about those today. We're going to see, first of all, today in our text, the instruction of the menorah, and we're going to talk about the illumination of the menorah. Let's begin with verse 31 of chapter 25. You shall also make a lampstand of pure gold. The lampstand shall be hammered work. Its shaft, its branches, its bowls, its ornamental knobs and flowers shall be of one piece. You're not going to put this together. It's one solid piece. And six branches shall come out of its side, three branches on the lampstand out of one side and three branches on the lampstand out of the other, making seven, the center being the middle branch. Verse 33, three bowls shall be made like almond blossoms on one branch with an ornamental knob and a flower, and three bowls made like almond blossoms on the other branch with an ornamental knob and a flower, and so for the six branches that come out of the lampstand. On the lampstand itself, four bowls shall be made like almond blossoms, each with its ornamental knob and flower. And there shall be a knob under the first two branches of the same, a knob under the second two branches of the same, and a knob under the third two branches of the same, according to the six branches that extend from the lampstand. Their knobs and their branches shall be of one piece. All of it shall be one hammered piece of pure gold. You shall make seven lamps for it, and they shall arrange its lamps so that they give light in front of it, and its wick trimmers and their trays shall be of pure gold. And that shall be made of a talent of pure gold with all these utensils. And see to it that you make them according to the pattern which was shown you on the mountain. We see in verse 31 through 36 the instruction of the menorah. Now there is an instruction, there is a blueprint that God has given Moses. There in Sinai, when he laid out the law and laid out all the different laws of the 613 commandments, God also gave them the plans for the tabernacle. What's very interesting is this. God gave the law saying to man, this is how you shall live. Realizing, knowing that the law was not a means of salvation, but rather it was a means of telling people, look, you can't keep the law. You are not holy. You're not perfect. You're not like me. So God showed his nature through the law, and that man's nature was indeed they couldn't keep the law. So there was a problem. They needed help. They needed forgiveness. They needed redemption. So God said, okay, I'm going to establish not just the civil law, but I'm going to establish the ceremonial law, which means you're going to bring sacrifices to me. You're going to bring redemption to me. You're going to have these different sacrifices so that I can forgive you of your sins, because without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. And God says, and therefore you're going to need a place to do this. I don't want you to do this at home. I don't want you to do this in your neighborhood. I want you to do this in one central place. Therefore, the tabernacle was given. Now within the tabernacle, as you have been seeing over the past few weeks, God is putting furniture as a pattern in this tabernacle so that men and women can know the truth about what the tabernacle is all about. It's about redemption. It's about forgiveness. It's about covering the sins till eventually Jesus, who comes on the scene, will wash away our sins. It's not by accident, as you saw in the first message on the tabernacle, that the furniture was placed in the form of a cross, that we might see the ultimate forgiveness, the ultimate washing away of sins would be through Jesus. And that's why we're going to take a look at the lampstand and we're going to see Jesus in it. What was its composition? What kind of composition did the menorah have? It was of pure gold. Now we've seen some of the other ones. They are gold and wood, acacia wood and gold. Talking about the incarnation, the divine nature of God, the gold, the wood pictured his humanity. This is not a picture in the lampstand. It is pure gold. It is one piece. It is the unity of gold. God is one. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. One piece of gold. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. United in unity. The word in the Hebrew is echad. We translate it as one. In reality, the word would be better translated in English as unity, meaning that three become one, a unity. And so we see here this element of God is in this picture of the lampstand. It was just gold, purest gold, picturing the deity or the divinity of Christ. That's very unique, because what we must understand is that the product of the lampstand is light. Light is not a picture of his humanity. Light was never, but we do not get the light of God because of his human nature. Light was never a part of the human nature of the incarnation, but rather light is a part of his divine nature. Only one element, gold, pictured the light of the world was not his humanity, but rather it was light speaking of his deity, the essence of God, that he is holy, that he is without sin. And so we see that light existed before his incarnation. The light was a picture of his divine nature. It was God who brought the light into the world. Revelation 21 and verse 23 says, "The city had no need of the sun," speaking of the new heaven and the new earth. "The city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light." God had even said in creation, "Let there be light," before the sun was created, before the moon and the stars were created. God said, "Let there be light," and the Bible says, "And there was light." So light was a picture of his divinity. So the menorah, the lampstand, what was it configured of? The Bible says it shall be hammered work. It shall be a hammered work. It's not to be cast. Oh, it'd be much easier to cast it, wouldn't it? Six branches coming out of a single branch here, and all the different ornamental knobs on it. My goodness, why can't you just cast it? Lord, just make a mold and cast it. It would be much, much more easier, because it was something very unique about the message of the construction of the lampstand. It was to be hammered. It was to be beaten. It was not to be molded. You see, molded is a work of man. It's a work of man. When they constructed the golden calf, when Moses and Joshua came down from the mountain, Joshua said, "I hear the sound of war." And lo and behold, it was them going around the golden calf and sinning and doing all their wonderful things that they did in the world. And God basically took care of all that matter through Moses. But bottom line is, they casted the calf. They made the calf themselves. Everything that is false worship is made by man, not God. And so we see here that God basically hammered, wanted the piece to be hammered. Why? Because this hammering, this beating, speaks of the suffering of God. The divinity of Christ, who came into this world to be beaten, to be literally lashed, to be beaten with his fist, to have his beard yanked out, to have him whipped with a cat of nine tails, to carry his cross up to the old rugged Calvary's hill. God's divine plan that Jesus would suffer for our sins, that we might see the light of God. And so God says, "I want you to hammer it." How in the world can we do this? Well, we see the menorah's characterization in verse 32 through 36. The prominent message of the menorah, as soon as you walked in as a priest and you looked there to your left, and there to the south of the tabernacle, the holy place, you saw the menorah. The first thing you saw was its seven branches. That was an obvious thing to you. It was a prominent message, the seven branches. Seven represents in the Word of God perfection or completion. And it talks about the completion of God's creative work at creation. Genesis 2:2 said, "And on the seventh day God ended his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done." And that's how we got the Sabbath day, which God said in his law was holy and that we ought to keep it according to the Jewish law. God said everything was perfect. It was completed. God completed the heavens and the earth in 6 days and rested on the seventh. But what about evolution, preacher? What is divine about evolution, by the way? What is the divine nature of evolution? Oh, they've come up with all manner of examples of what happened. Originally, it was a big burst. Boom! It was a big boom. A big blast. And everything was put in space and it started to spin, and suddenly two little molecules got together and you got life. Well, beloved, that's not the way it started. Well, they've got facts, preacher. They got facts. They've got facts, but they're not true facts. We have facts too, folks. You got it right there sitting on your lap. It's called the Word of God. Well, how does he know it was created that way? Duh. He created it. He was there. These evolutionists, they don't know. They'll tell you. We don't know how it started. Oh, it started with the Big Bang. Well, who made the Big Bang? Well, we don't know. Well, where did that star come from that exploded? We don't know. Well, who caused the energy to blow up like that? We don't know. Well, I do. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. He said, bang, and it was there. The bottom line was simple. This seven-branch menorah pictured God's work of creation. Well, what a glorious opportunity that God gave us. And then also, it was talked about the completion of Christ's conciliatory work at the cross. What did Jesus say as he hung upon the cross? He said, it is finished. It's completed. It's perfect. I did it the way that God had said it would be done. And we see the completion of Christ's work on the cross. Hebrews 1:3 said, who being the brightness of his glory and the expressed image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he, Jesus, had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. He said, it's finished. It's completed. And so what we see as we walk in the tabernacle, if we were one of the priests in the time of Exodus, we would look and see seven branches. Oh, that pictures the 6 days of creation. And the seventh day God rested. But you see, what they didn't know is that it also pointed to the completion of our salvation. It pictured hanging upon a tree a perfect Savior, a completed work at Calvary. And therefore, though they worshiped on the Sabbath day for creation, we worship on the Lord's day for the completion of the Calvary's salvation. We see the prominent message of the lampstand. But I want you to look at the poignant motif of it. Something very interesting about it. We see all the vines and we see all the different things on this menorah in our handout. What was the emphasis in all of this? In verse 33 and 34, we see the almond emphasis. The almond emphasis. Now, we talked about this when we talked about Aaron's rod that budded, that the almond tree pictured the resurrection. Why? Because it was the first of all the trees to bud in Israel. It was the first to come back to life after the winter. It was the first in springtime to start to show life in the Holy Land, sometimes as early as January. It's an amazing thing. If you go to Israel, you'll find out that they have more than one season of harvest. You can go there and they'll have sometimes two or three harvest times. It's an amazing place. You can go there, and we went there in February and March, and lo and behold, we were up in Galilee in the beautiful, lush, green areas and valleys of Galilee, and someone told us it snowed in Jerusalem. They shut the whole city down. Nobody knew what to do with it. You can get online and see Jerusalem sometimes in the snow. It's beautiful. But what we see, folks, is that God in the springtime would bring this almond tree, and it would begin to bud, and it would begin to blossom, and the fruit would come. And it was a picture of the resurrection that Jesus came. Aaron's rod was the same. It had a bud. It had not only the bud, but it had the flower. Not only the flower, but it had the fruit. A dead stick. A branch off an almond tree, obviously, that Aaron had taken and used as a rod. It had been dead. We don't know how long he had used it. Obviously, it had been in the wilderness for several years. And lo and behold, that dead branch came back to life. It not only budded, it bore a flower, and then it bore fruit, which again pictures the resurrection of Jesus. It is a threefold picture. We see that in verse 35 and 36. We've got knobs. We've got branches. We've got flowers, buds, pictured as a threefold stage of the almond tree. The bud first, the flower next, and then the fruit. And you see, this also pictures for us the three stages of Jesus' life. The bud being the incarnation. He was born into this world of a virgin named Mary. And then we see the flower, that's his life. He came into this world as a great light. And he pictured for us the perfect life. And he died for us the perfect Savior. This is a picture of a beautiful flower. That if you take that flower from apart from its plant and you pull it aside, put it in a vase for a little while, it'll live, but it'll eventually die. You see, that's the sadness of real flowers. That's the sadness of giving a rose to someone. That's the sadness of giving a flower to somebody because it only lasts for so long. And you see, the flower pictured for us the life and the death of Jesus. Though it was beautiful, though it was here for a short time, it died on the cross. But then there's the fruit. And what is the fruit? He came back from the dead. He rose from the dead. He came to give us life eternal. We have the hope that is ours in Christ, that when death comes and knocks on our door, beloved, when death comes and places its icy hand upon our shoulder, we can tell it, get your hand off me. I want Jesus. And that's all it takes, beloved. And we see here the allegorical embellishment. The picture of the lampstand pictured for us, the life, the birth, the life, and the death of Jesus. Next, we see in verse 37 through 40, not only the instruction, but the illumination of the menorah. Oh, we look at that large piece of solid gold, beautiful gold. The light of that menorah lit up that whole room. And by the way, the walls of that room were gold. The other furniture around them were gold, polished gold. And beloved, you could see your reflection in. But as the light of the only light of the menorah would flicker, you'd see this glorious golden room that you are in with all these golden things. Folks, that's the true likeness of our service. Oh, beloved, one day we're going to have that golden crown. One day we're going to stand in the golden streets of heaven. We're going to walk in the golden halls of judgment there at Christ's judgment seat there at the Bema Seat judgment. And lo and behold, we're going to get the golden crown. All of it pictures the loveliness of Jesus. We see in verse 37 pictures in the lampstand. It was provided to produce light. It was the only source of light in the entire tabernacle. There was no light in that except that when God's Holy Spirit, God's Shekinah glory, would appear in the Holy of Holies, that's the other light that would be there. But overall, the only light that would continue on was the lampstand. That pictures for us the light of the world, Jesus. He is the path of light. There is no other light. We cannot see what this world is all about. We cannot understand life. We cannot grasp the things of life unless we are walking in the light. Jesus said in John, the 12th chapter, verse 46, I have come as light into the world, that whoever believes in me should not abide, should not live in darkness. Beloved, we have a hope in Christ. Jesus came that you and I would not no longer grovel in the darkness, that we'd no longer stumble in the dirt, that we'd no longer spend our lives groveling about trying to find our way like blind men and women, but that God would give us purpose, that he would bring light into our life as a path that we could follow. And then he is the persona of light. He is light. John 8:12 says, and then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world, and he who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Beloved, we have the light of life. You say, well, I get confused sometimes. Well, I don't know about you, but if somebody shines a light in your eyes, you can be confused for a little bit. Remember in the old days how they had those little flash bulbs on their camera? I hated those things. You know, and so they're going to improve. And then they made, remember the flash cubes? They had four of them on a little thing that would swim. You know, and by the time they got done with four pictures, you couldn't see to walk. I mean, those big flash bulbs pop, go off, and you'd stand there and you'd be blind for about 3 minutes. But you see, here's the bottom line. The light was not meant that we stare into it like some goat in the pasture, but that we walk in it, that we live in it. We see his persona of light. Next, not only was it a picture of the light of the world, Jesus, but it was a picture of the light of the witness, the Holy Spirit. The Bible says there were seven lamps to be put on top of this menorah. They made seven little lamps. You put the oil in it, put the wick in it, and you place it on top of the menorah. According to the Jewish commentaries, all the wicks would point toward the middle lamp, that all the light would go towards the middle lamp. But we see here, beloved, the sevenfold nature of the Holy Spirit. What do you mean the sevenfold nature of the Holy Spirit? Isaiah 11:2. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. These are the representations, the nature of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the Lord. He is the Spirit of wisdom. He is the Spirit of understanding. You say, preacher, I don't understand the Bible. Pray. Ask the Holy Spirit to give you wisdom. Ask the Holy Spirit to reveal, and he'll give you that. He's the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of might, that's power, the Spirit of knowledge, the Spirit of the fear of the Lord. Many people don't fear the Lord today. That's one of the problems, not only in the world, but it's a problem in Christendom today. We've lost our fear of the Lord. You know, beloved, we're going to stand before him one day. We're going to stand before Jesus. We're going to give an account of our life as we live for him. We're going to have a count. He says, did you do this? I asked you to go here. Did you go there? And different places and different things like that. And beloved, our works are going to be judged, not our sins. Those have been judged at Calvary. Oh, those have been judged all the way back at the brazen laver. The brazen altar. We're in the place of the work. We're in the place where the priests go. We're in the place where the lampstand is. We're in the holy place. You don't get there, folks, unless you go by way back here in the beginning when you first come in the tabernacle. Here it is, the brazen altar, your sacrifice, the blood and all is applied there. Then you go past, you get into the brazen laver. Next you go into the holy place. There's the table of showbread, the fellowship, and then you got the lampstand over here. Folks, it's not talking about your sins. It's talking about your works, your service for God. Did you do that for Jesus? Did you give that recommendation to come to church because you love Jesus? Did you play that piano because you love Jesus? Did you teach that Sunday school class because you love Jesus? Did you sing that solo because you love Jesus? Did you preach that sermon because you love Jesus? Folks, our works will be judged in the light of the Holy Spirit. There is no fear today. Revelation 3:1 says, and to the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things says, he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, and I know your works, that you have a name that you are alive, but you are dead. So we see that the light of the witness. Finally, there's the light of the word, the Bible. You see, it's a light for our walk. It's the light of God illuminating our walk. When you go into the holy place, it's dark without the light. That's why the first thing the priest did, he went in and lit the lamp. That's the first thing you did in the morning. You did your sacrifices, and then you walked in and you lit the lamp. And then you went to the altar of incense. But we see here, folks, you had to have light for the walk. Oh, that's in Psalm 119:105. We learned this as a child. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light to my path. Oh, beloved, listen. Can't see. If you can't see, you can't walk. If you can't see, you can't go down and do that work for Jesus. We see not only the light for our walk, but light for our wisdom. You see, the light informs and the light imparts. John 16:13 says, and however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you in all truth. For he will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak and he will tell you things to come. The Holy Spirit is here to teach you the things of Jesus. And so we come to this lampstand. We see the light of the world, Jesus. We see the light of the witness, the Holy Spirit. And we see the light of the Word, the Bible. Next in verse 38 and 40, because we used 39 in the beginning. In verse 38, we see the provision in the lampstand. In verse 38, we see the menorah's accessories. There were some little things that kind of went around the menorah, the lampstand. There were little trimmers, wick trimmers. There were little plates that you put the ashes of the wick. You just didn't throw it down on the ground. You carried that ash from the wick because it was holy. Even the ash that fell off the wick was considered holy. And you would take it out to a place of disposal that was holy. And you put it in the little plates. And you took your trimmers and your tongs you would use to move the wick in it. Or you would cut the wick with the trimmers. All these things were used for a purpose. They were implements to purify, to cleanse the lampstand. They were used to cleanse the lampstand. Or you take little spoons and you'd scoop out the excess or whatever was dirt inside that lamp. And you would clean it out. And you would use that, those implements to purify and to cleanse the lamp. And then there were implements to prepare also. You would prepare the lamp. You would take those tongs, the clippers, and you would cut the wick right. And you'd have it laced just right and ready to go in the morning. And so you prepared for the next day to minister again. But these implements were made of pure gold. Why? Because they were divine. They represented the divine nature of Jesus. Why? Oh, folks, 1 John 1:9 tells us why. If we'll confess our sins. He is faithful and just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, beloved, it's simple. He's got to trim here and there once in a while. He's got to take that wick, this little light of mine. I'm going to let it shine. Sometimes when we were little kids in vacation Bible school, we used to scream that song from the top of our lungs. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. But folks, as we have grown older, our wicks have got a little need to be repaired. We need to do a little trimming here and there. But the Holy Spirit tells us you need a little repair. The Holy Spirit tells us you need a little cleansing here. And we take the implements of confession. And we take the implements of confession and faithfulness and forgiveness. And the Lord cleanses us and readies for us for tomorrow for a new day to follow and worship Him. Now, beloved, God may need to cleanse the trim the lights and to pour the right oil in our lives. That's why in the morning when you first get up and at night before you go to bed, you ought to apply the trimmers for the wicks at night and pray to the Lord and ask for His forgiveness. In verse 40, we see the menorah's allowance, what it shares. The pattern is shared here in verse 40. And see to it that you make them according to the pattern. He said, I don't want you going off on your own, Moses. I don't want you doing something goofball. We don't know how tall the menorah is, didn't say. We don't know how wide it is. But God showed him. God showed him exactly in the pattern. He said, I want you to make it according to the blueprint I've given you out of the temple of heaven. Now, Hebrews 8:5 says, we serve the copy and the shadow of the heavenly things. As Moses was divinely instructed when he was about to make the tabernacle, for he said, see that you make all things according to the pattern shown you on the mountain. Now, folks, what he said was, I've got just like this in heaven, and I want on earth. That's why Jesus said, when you learn to pray, you say, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Folks, listen. We are to live like heaven on earth. We are to live as God is here with us because He is. And we are to live according to His word and His way. We see the pattern is shared. But there was a little confusion here. And there was a presentation shown here. Look at verse 40 again. According to the pattern, here it comes, which was shown you on the mountain. The Jewish commentaries have a very interesting note on this. They said God had given them the instructions. Moses had written them all out. He knew from God's word what he was to do. But when it came to the menorah and to hammer it out, Moses became a little confused here. He had no clue. How am I going to do this? What do we need to do? And according to the Jewish commentaries, God showed him. Showed him the lampstand. Showed him in a fiery lampstand the way he wanted it. Now, beloved, here's the thing. We come to God and God says, I'm bringing a Savior to you. And you say, well, what kind of Savior? What kind of Savior will it be, God? And God says to you today, oh, stretch out your arms. Stretch out your arms. And that's how I'm going to bring a Savior to you. Well, what does that mean? And God placed within His Word the fiery picture of Jesus hanging upon the cross. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Oh, we see in the Psalms the Savior as He hung upon the cross. We see in Isaiah where the Bible says, and God was pleased to bruise Him. We see in the Gospels how Jesus was crucified on the cross. How He was beaten for our iniquities. How He was bruised for our sins. And how He hung upon that old rugged cross to say, "For God, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Oh, beloved, we had a picture shown us. God in human flesh, incarnated that He might die for us. You see, light illuminates, and light informs, and light imparts. That's what the lampstand was all about. It speaks to us of the major three of the Bible. Jesus, the light of the world. The Holy Spirit, the light of the witness. And the Bible, the light of the Word. Psalm 18:28 says, for you will light my lamp. The Lord my God will enlighten my darkness. Oh, beloved Christian, are you walking in darkness? Then you need to light the lamp. You need to trim the wick. You need to pour the oil. You need to get before the Lord and say, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the light of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Oh, beloved, we need to live for Jesus. Finally, let's close with 1 John chapter 1. All the way back to the opposite end of the Bible, almost to the book of Revelation. You go from Revelation back to Jude, 3 John, 2 John, and 1 John chapter 1. 1 John chapter 1. And we'll conclude with this, starting with verse 5. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. Verse 6. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked. Verse 7, brethren, I write no new commandment to you, but an old commandment, which have been from the beginning. The old commandment which you have heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write to you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is a passing away, and the true light is already shining. Verse 9, he who says he's in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now. He who loves his brother abides in the light, and there's no cause for stumbling in him. We see in verse 11, but he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Beloved, we are either in the light or we are out of the light. We are either walking in the light or we're walking out of the light. Christian, let me ask you, how are you walking today? Do you need to trim that trim? Do you need to trim that wick? Do you need to pour more oil? Do you need to get ready for the day? Beloved, this altar is for you. Perhaps, beloved, you've never come to Christ. You've never received Jesus. You've never been saved, never been born again. This is your day too. If you'll come to the light, I promise you, you'll never be disappointed. Jesus said, come unto me, all you heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. If you come, I promise you, He'll wash away your sins. He'll put the light of the love of God in your life, and you will not walk in darkness anymore. Let's pray. Hi, my name is John Blair, and I have the privilege of being the pastor here at Coventry Baptist Church in Fort Wayne, Indiana. I want to thank you for choosing to take part in our online services. I sincerely hope they were a blessing to you, and I want to invite you to continue to use them in the weeks yet ahead. In fact, take your time on our website, check it out, let us know what you think about it. Your opinion is very important to us, and we'd like to have some feedback. Let me take this time
to also extend an invitation to you. If you don't already have a church home, let me invite you to come to our church and take part in one of our weekly services. Our morning worship service on Sunday is at 10 a.m. Our Sunday night service is at 6 p.m. And our Wednesday services and our midweek service is at 7 o'clock p.m. We're located at 10926 Aboit Center Road. We're right across the street from Homestead High School. Just get on our website. We have a detailed map and some instructions on how to get here. Again, thank you for choosing our website and our services. I pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you. I hope to see you this Sunday.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christ Jesus.